Greetings. My name is Tony Fauci, and I'm the director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases. And I'm very pleased to be with you today to make a very brief presentation to open up this workshop, this virtual workshop on the airborne transmission of SARS coronavirus 2. I'm going to briefly address some of the public health and scientific challenges associated with the challenge of COVID-19. As we're all well aware, at the end of December, the beginning of January, it became clear that there was a novel coronavirus that emerged almost certainly from an animal reservoir and began infecting humans. It was not known at first the efficiency with which this spread from human to human. And in fact, it was thought originally that it was merely a jumping species from an animal to a human. But very quickly, as the weeks and the months rolled out, it became clear that this new SARS coronavirus, which is a virus that is the third of the pandemic coronaviruses following SARS coronavirus 1 in 2002 and MERS coronavirus in 2012. The one shown right now in yellow is SARS coronavirus 2, which is phylogenetically linked closely to SARS coronavirus 1. And so we have the disease called COVID-19, for coronavirus disease 2019, caused by the novel coronavirus, which we've designated SARS coronavirus 2. Again, from its early beginning of not being sure how well it could transmit, it exploded over in the subsequent months to a pandemic, a global pandemic of historic proportions, the worst we've seen of a global pandemic in the last 102 years since 1918. Right now, there are 22 million individuals who've been infected globally, with over 780,000 deaths. The United States has been hit harder than any country in the world, with almost 5.5 million cases and over 170, by most recent count, 1,000 deaths in this country. The transmission is well known. It's a respiratory-borne virus. Transmission between people in close contact, transmission via particles that remain in the air over time and distance, the discussion of this particular workshop. Surfaces can be infected, and the virus can live on those surfaces for up to 48 or longer hours. The role in transmission is not entirely clear using inanimate objects. In addition, virus is found in a variety of body fluids. Again, its role in transmission is not well known, nor is the role of animals who rarely can get infected, both domesticated animals and zoo animals. One thing that has been very clear with this virus that is very troublesome and problematic is the fact that about 40 to 45% of individuals who are infected are without symptoms, and that asymptomatic individuals have now been clearly documented to transmit the virus from person to person, making it extremely problematic with regard to tracking these infections and to do identification, isolation, and contact tracing. The risk of transmission, it depends on the type and the duration of exposure, whether one uses preventive measures, individual factors, such as the viral load in the respiratory secretions. Infections are most common secondarily among household contacts, in congregate or healthcare settings, when individuals do not wear personal protective equipment, and in closed settings, such as cruise ships, prisons, nursing homes, meatpacking plants. We've seen numerous clusters of cases after social or work gatherings, where you highlight the risk of transmission through close non-household contact. We've seen that in choirs. We've seen that in celebrations within homes. We've seen that in church celebrations. There are some key questions that remain regarding transmission. What is the role of various types of respiratory particles in SARS coronavirus 2 transmission? At what concentration is infectious virus contained in these various types of particles of different sizes, from very small less than 5 micrometers to 20, 30, 40, 50, 100 or more micrometers. How is the concentration of infectious virus affected by various environmental conditions? And what is the dose of virus that's needed to establish infection in various anatomic sites? Hopefully, this workshop will shed some light on that. In other words, we need to understand the mechanism of transmission if we are to properly inform public health guidance. It will impact the forcefulness with which we do masking and how strongly we recommend it, which should be very strong. The degree of ventilation and indoor and environmental conditions, how we clean and disinfect particles, the importance of physical distancing and transmission in healthcare settings. Hopefully, we will get greater insight in all of these as this workshop progresses. So I want to thank you for giving me the opportunity to make a brief presentation, and I wish you a successful workshop.